Hello, welcome one and all to Code Weaver Plays Games. Well, doing yet a third game this Sunday, and I think the audio is coming through okay. Okay, I'm going to call that good for the moment. Hopefully everybody will be able to see that I'm going to play. Here we go. Not that. There we go. So I'm on my quest. But this time, I'm not doing a climbing game. Today, I'm in my Quest headset, my Quest 2, strictly speaking. I am going to play, once I get the right controllers and the right hands, I'm going to play none of these that are in my immediate vicinity. So we're going to do a search. We're going to do a search for Tokyo Chronos. Now, shown actually in one of my Facebook feeds or some feed or other. Hang on, sorry, I'm just adjusting myself in my space here. This third one in the series, which kind of attracted me because it's kind of a detective novel. Once I found it was part of a series, it's like, well, why not go all the way back to the beginning and see what it's about? And if I like it, great. And if I don't, I'll move on and see what happens. But I just came off a really wonderful game story called My Child Lebensborn, which pretty much had me needing tissues by the end of it. Got me sniffly, and it was very heartfelt and bittersweet, and I loved it. I need another story game, and I need another story game that is probably going to be slightly, well, maybe, I have no idea, might be slightly less cripplingly tear-jerking by the end of it. And anyway, so I'm going to do a story thing. Now, I don't do a whole lot of visual novels, but visual novels that have some choices in them are kind of interesting now and again. And you know what? Let's just give it a go. I'm going to give it a go. I don't know what to expect. It's definitely going to have an anime theme to it. Hopefully there's English in it, or this is going to be very short. I don't mind subtitles, so that's just fine. But the fact that it's in VR makes it extra interesting. So let's just spark it up immediately. I'm just going to keep an eye on the stream and make sure that nothing completely ridiculous is going on. Yeah, I think we seem to be okay. And again, audio's coming through. Okay, here we go. Check this out. So I'm in the space. Now, of course, none of you can see this in three dimensions. So all that I can do is help to try to give you a feel for what the game looks like. Now, I got to get a little bit further back so my guardian doesn't keep triggering. I'm going to start by playing this in my sitting down position. And if that works, great. Player height. Is this meant for me to be standing? I don't know. I mean, I don't mind if it is. I would have expected a visual novel not to worry about that too much, but we'll find out as we go. And if we have to come back here to change this, then that's the way it goes. Language. Definitely going with that. That's fine. Help. Oh, here we go. Oculus Quest, move stick, click to show and hide text. That's fine. Move stick to scroll, open and close the menu. Okay, that's fine. That's normal. Confirm your next page, show Oculus menu. I don't know how much of this is actually going to involve choices, but let's just find out. I do like myself a good story, and if the gameplay is secondary to a well-told story, sometimes that can be okay. Okay, trigger to continue.
過去に戻って人生をやり直したい。そうしたら
I want to travel back in time and redo my life. Then things would turn out differently. So I might not be able to read everything that happens because I don't want to talk over the audio of the actual game. So what I'm going to do... Okay, hang on. I'm going to make sure that my computer actually transmits a small amount of the game volume compared to my voice. And unfortunately, I have no way to verify exactly what the audio level is. I can see that this ticking is okay, but what I'm going to do is I may end up having to speak over. Oh, hello. Sanjay, good morning. The streaming is not very smooth today. I can't sleep properly today. I'm going to gloss over the medical problems. I hope you're enjoying playing the game as always. Yes, I'm sorry it's not smooth. I don't know what that's all about, but in any case. So we're at a situation where I can hear, so I'm in my Quest headset, so if I don't get to the stream chat, forgive me, I will try to keep an eye on it just under my visor to make sure I can see if anybody's talking or not. So what's gonna happen here is I'm going to try to read some of the text because this is not going to be spoken in English. There is gonna be English text. So we're just gonna play this by ear and see if we can make this work on stream. But the audio of the game is going to be quieter than what I am hearing. So forgive me if I shout. I'm sure I'm not the only one who's thought that. If I made a different choice back then things would be so much better now. But is that really the case? I simply chose what I thought was the best decision I could have made at the time. If I was to be faced with the same situation as I had, then I would have made the same choice regardless. And it's that decision that led me up to this point, right? If that's the case, a redo isn't what's needed. Okay. To change the worst outcome, what's truly needed is... And before I click forward, I'd just like to say the character's head is tracking the motion of my physical head in this space. The hands aren't yet, and I don't have tilt motion on the head. But this is kind of a compelling medium because I am seeing effectively myself in a mirror, and my eyes are... I mean, it's obviously... The Quest isn't tracking my eyes. The Quest doesn't have that tech. Hopefully future headsets... who knows, right? But because I'm constantly looking at the character's eyes, it kind of feels like the eyes are following me. Anyway, moving on. Oh, hello. Okay. So... Oh, that's dark. Looks like I have blood on my hands. It's following my head and it's not following my controllers, but maybe that'll change. Okay. Oh, hello. Okay, where am I? Wow, okay, so... I think it has me, like I'm in a seated position, it has me actually as a very tall person, I don't know if that's intentional. Oh, that's kind of unsettling. Looking around, I'm at the top of some sort of apartment or office building. Oh, hello. Why are you falling? Okay. Well, this should be exciting. Okay, looking around, it says, I gasp for air. Now I'm seeing glass panels with tape on them. Probably the panels have just been put in place. There's a staircase leading up. Red metal, probably scaffolding, or maybe red wood. It could be wood. Bolted wood. And probably plastic sheeting on the outside like you may have to protect the outside of an office building being built before it's been completed. So inside a building that's being built or partially being built. Same thing with those great big sheets. Some industrial stuff above us. It's a plain room, but it illustrates the environment nicely. I gasp for air. I come to my senses already on my feet, like I was shaken awake. What the? I've never seen this place. I trace my memories, but I have no idea what this place is. It's good, because I have no idea what this place is. Heck, I can't even remember how I got here to begin with. The last thing I remember is that I got into bed and slept as usual. Just what happened? Ow! I try to recall, but pain races through my head. What the hell? Am I dreaming here? It feels far too real to be a dream. My consciousness is as clear as day, too. I can see someone on my right. It startles me. What? Wait, oh, hello. I am kind of startled by that. Fair enough. That's me? Well, except that it's not tracking me. Oh, but I have hands. Hello, I have hands. Do I have... Okay. I squint and see me, Kyosuke Sakurai. Oh my god, I'm going to mangle every name imaginable, and I've watched a lot of anime, so this shit is kind of inexcusable. Huh. I'm gonna say Sakurai. Sakurai? Sakurai? Somebody with some Japanese, help me. Hello, huh, just a pane of glass. Hey, goodbye, I need to get some sleep now. Yeah, okay, Sanjay, I hope that you have a good sleep. Just a pane of glass, okay. I feel an incongruity with myself in the glass. Like, it's me, but it's not me. Okay. His existence feels pale, like it's missing something crucial. Feels incomplete. I just can't accept that being me. Is this a feeling of loss or something lacking? Did I come here without anything on me? I thrust my hands into my pockets, but there's nothing in them. Okay. I check my jacket pocket to be sure. The phone I always carry around isn't there, and neither is the student handbook I've always left in it. What's going on? My voice reverberates through the room, and a sense of isolation assails me. I've been thrust in here, alone, in this incomprehensible space. My body stands stiff, and I get goosebumps. What the heck is this place? What was I doing? Let's just go home for now. Once I get out of here, I'll figure out where this place is. Haha, look at you, pathetic. He's wearing the same uniform as I am. Very interesting art style. Oh, hey, Lello! Okay. He is in three dimensions. That's pretty cool. Cell shading style. Alright. He's wearing the same uniform as I am. But I've never seen him before, so he can't be the same year that I am. Maybe a first year or a third year? Who are you? I'm Lo, your friend. You don't remember? Though he said that he's my friend, I've never seen him before. Lo. I vocalize his name, but nothing comes to me. I can't remember. Hey, hey, come on. We're in the same class. 2-3, right? Why did he suddenly tell such an obvious lie? But if I call him out on it now, it might make the mood even worse. Sorry, I really can't remember. Damn. Must be great to have it so easy. Huh? I said you must enjoy yourself when all you do is shut the bad stuff out without a second thought. What are you even talking about? Hey, that's right. You? Do you know what you've done? What the heck have you got going on? What the heck have you going on about? Not terribly good English, but that's alright. What is up with this guy? I've only just met him, but it sucks that he isn't even listening. That said, I can't wave him off and leave either. I want to at least exchange information about our current situation. So what is this place? Dunno. Do you remember how you ended up here? Dunno. Where'd you come from just now? Dunno. Hey, enough joking around. I really don't know where this is or why I'm here. I don't have my phone and I don't remember how I got here either. Well, isn't that just awful? But hey, you get what you deserve. What do you mean? Do you actually know something? He's clearly acting strange. He's at least a bit uneasy. Seems to have gotten used to this completely insane situation. Fear stems from ease of the unknown. Which means maybe he knows something about this current situation. Yeah, I do. But where this is and why you're here. Everything. Then tell me. No way, I don't feel like it. But if you really want me to tell you... Oh, jeez. Make me.
Okay, that's unsettling.
Hello? You're fairly muscular, you're holding me above you, and that's really creepy. Erg. You're always like this. You can never do anything worthless. Now, okay. If you want to change the outcome, then you gotta change yourself. Just what are you talking about? Huh, you still don't get it. What are you up to? Oh, might you not know? Wait, stop. This scene overlaps with another that I've seen. Ugh. My head hurts. What is this? A school roof. Someone stands there. Their hair blows in the wind, then they... Quit joking around. Come back here. Feelings come rising up from deep within me. Is there anything else around me? I just want to make sure I'm not missing anything. That would be sneaky. Don't let him fall. I must save him. Low. Stop. Low. I continue to shout a name I don't know, trying to stop its foolishness. Low. But how exactly are you going to save me, huh? All right. Everybody's wearing jetpacks in this game. Low. He fell. I take a deep breath. I slowly look down, but no one is there. Huh? Low should have fallen. I'm sure of it. Low! Whoa. Scared? What an idiot. He probably used some construction scaffolding as footing for his landing. Kyosuke, I'm not going to be seeing you again. Hey, Low! What the heck is up with that guy? What just happened back there? I definitely have no recollection of this place, and it doesn't look to be a dream. Is it amnesia, or did I sleepwalk here? But if that's the case, why does Low know what's going on? I exhaust all the possibilities, but none of them seem plausible to me. Either way, this isn't accomplishing anything. Anyway, let's go outside. Without a smartphone, I can't contact anyone. I don't know where this is, but I can probably figure it out once I'm outside. If I have absolutely no idea where I am, I can just ask. All right. Well, hello. All right. Some of the building into some kind of back alley. All right. Looking up and around. All right. Fair enough. There's a sense of familiarity, but that might just be me. There are countless similar views within Tokyo. It's quiet. There's nothing else making sound. This seems to be a bustling city area, so why is it that there isn't even a trace of people? I make my way to the alley's entrance. For starters, I can figure out where this is if I can meet someone. Then I can get home. Oh wait, I don't have my wallet on me. Or any ID for that matter. Which means I can't use any public transport, so I'll need to get to a police station and phone home. Someone. Anyone. I need to find an actual human. I'm out of the alley. Huh. I wish they'd taken me out of the alley, but... Oh, hello. Maybe they have.
Shibuya.
Hello. Shibuya. This is... very empty. But it's a nice sort of 3D rendered scene, at least partially 3D rendered. Just a commentary on the visuals here. So the backdrops are all flattish, kind of low res buildings, but distant enough that that doesn't matter too much. The trees and the islands that they're on are all certainly two dimensional, flat billboards. But again, at enough of a distance, that doesn't matter too much. Any parallax? There's actually a little bit of parallax. You might be able to just barely see it. I can't in my vision of the lamppost moving against the tree. So if they are billboards, they've been very carefully placed to preserve some of the three-dimensional sensation, but also some of the parallax. So if I got up and walked around my apartment, you'd probably be able to see it a little bit more. I don't think I'm going to try to do that since I'm already sitting, but it's not bad for the style. All right. I reach Shibuya's scramble intersection. I really do remember that alley. Though I don't go through there anymore since I have no reason to. I used to all the time back in elementary. I sigh, relieved that I'm just in Shibuya. Since elementary up till now, as a second year high school student, I've been coming to school here. I know Shibuya like the back of my own hand. Wait, what? It just hit me. There's nobody here, not anyone, not a single soul. Huh? This is near Shibuya Station, the famous Shibuya Scramble. Is this even possible for no one to be here? Yeah, no, it is not. What's going on? This is as if time is frozen within Shibuya. What the heck? Well, I mean, not really frozen, or we see a lot of people that are frozen. It's a little bit more like it's like the middle of the night, but everything's been lit up so that there's just nobody here. What the heck? There's clearly something going on here. My body shivers from the terror of that. Could I possibly be the only person left in all Shibuya? chill runs through my spine. I can't breathe right. The empty silence is oppressive. The pressure bears down on me. No, impossible. That low guy was there just now. There has to be someone else here. Hello? Is anyone there? I shout, but my voice vanishes into the buildings without so much as an echo. Scramble isn't the right place to be trying this. Maybe I should try it at the station. It's a closed area, so my voice should travel pretty far inside. And I can't imagine the station staff, practically fixtures at this point, not being there. From the scramble, I break into a light sprint towards the station. Something enters my field of vision. There's someone squatting beside the Hachiko statue. Is it letting me see that yet? Or is it in the next panel? Let's make sure I'm not missing anything. Okay. Another person. I don't see the statue they're talking about. I'm elated at the moment I see someone else. Excuse me! I really wish they had a statue in this scene for me to focus on, or I am missing it. When I called out to them, they turned around like they were being reeled in. They stand up as I wave. She's wearing a pleated skirt and a Y shirt, the same uniform as my school. Hey! Thank God, a person, a real, oh hello, there we are. Real, actual human being. Huh? To get closer, so does she, at great speed. Her face looks familiar.
You?
Kyosuke! There's no mistaking it. That's you, Momono. Yo!
Kyosuke!
I think I'm not going to repeat that because I can't do the voice justice, but. Alright. I was so scared. Yeah, it's really me. Could you, let me go for now? No, I really was so scared. Like, maybe there really isn't anyone around. A crybaby like always. That hasn't changed. Yeah, that's a pretty good model. I like the attention to the eyelashes. The eyes are a little weird because they've been kind of got sort of... I don't have hands to gesture in this mode. Kind of inverted pupils because they delve into the eye, which is kind of an odd effect at short range. I guess that's because they haven't mapped it to like an eyeball. But whatever. I mean, it's as a drawing, it works relatively well. All right. Let's see here. Around others, you would act all prim and proper. But because we grew up together our whole lives like a brother and sister, she's always been at ease when we're together, and so often opened up to me. Yeah, it sure was crazy, but it's all right now. Okay. Momono, thanks. It's a stroke of luck that the person I met isn't some random stranger, but you. I feel the most comfortable around her. We've been next-door neighbors our whole lives. We went to the same elementary, middle, and high schools, too. To think we've been pulled into the same situation, too. Maybe we share the same fate or something. Hey, what's going on here? Where's everyone else? I don't even remember coming to Shibuya. I was just sleeping at home, and then all of a sudden I'm here. You too, huh? Same with me. Did you see anyone else? I've been here about 10 minutes, but I haven't seen anyone yet. Where'd you come from? I was asleep at home. Then when I came to, I was in that building over there. I see. I woke up by Spinzaka Slope. Spainzaka, huh? Spainzaka Slope is northwest of Shibuya Station. There's a number of trendy shops along the road. Though the place isn't entirely styled after Spain, it ended up getting that nickname for some reason. I don't go there as I never really have any reason to. That brings back memories. We used to go there all the time back in elementary. Not that there was anything worth going to. They had Gachapon there. Gacha was there? You forgot? For some reason, you cast her gaze down, looking hurt. Seeing her expression jogs my memory. There was a building with a row of the capsule toy machines outside. There were all sorts of kinds available, and as kids we often rolled around the gacha and traded the prizes we got. We often rolled the gacha and traded the prizes we got. All right. Ah, I remember, yeah, that weird looking place. Nowadays we really don't do that anymore, so we stopped going. I could still probably find those toys if I weren't sure on my stuff at home. I think we also tried to complete entire sets together, too. What's wrong? Not feeling well? No, I'm fine. All good. It's nothing. Really? Okay, then. You can really overdo it sometimes. She has a bright, open personality. She also has a lot of friends. However, she sometimes has these solitary, pensive moments. I'm probably the only one who sees that side of her. What do we do now? It's reassuring to have a companion now, but that doesn't exactly make us any closer figuring a situation out. I suppose getting home would be a good step forward. You, do you have your phone on you? Nope. I don't have my bag either, or my handbook, just my camera. Yu takes her digital camera out of her pocket. It's always on hand so she can take photos to remember anything by. She's part of the photography club, and she takes such good photos that even laypersons can tell how good she is with a camera. Seriously? I've got absolutely nothing on me. Same thing, once the battery on this thing dies, that'll be it. Anyway, I was thinking of heading home for now. What do you think? I quickly check to see if anybody's in my chat room. It does not look like it, but that is okay. I thought about that too, but the trains aren't running. Seriously? I completely forgot to consider that. No people and no trains. It all makes sense, really. Huh? Really, this is really dead for a space this big. But anyway, a city can seem so distant, like a separate entity that runs on its own, like a singular system. But it can only operate with the cooperation of a huge number of people. Without those people, Shibuya doesn't run the situation that drives the point. This situation drives that point home. What now? I guess you got no choice but to walk home. How long is that going to take? We'll probably get home before the sun goes down, but I've never actually walked home before, so I have no idea how long exactly. Alright. Actually, will going home accomplish anything? The idea of going home was really just based on the assumption that my family would be there and things would work themselves out. But without a single soul left in Shibuya, it feels like there wouldn't be anyone at all, anywhere. I'm fairly certain something big is going on. Way bigger than just on the scale of you and I. I gasp, anxious. No, I'm thinking too negatively about this. Let's just look for someone else for now. There might be someone who knows something, like Lo. We need to gather more information. Look, over there. Look there. Isn't that someone there? Where? Huh, where? Look there, there's someone by the edge. Oh, wow, way up there. You're right, it's a person. We found yet another. It's a girl wearing a uniform, the same as our school's. For some reason, she's by the edge of the roof, looking up at the sky. It startles me again. First Lo, now her. Why does everyone keep standing someplace scary? Hey, that's dangerous. She doesn't show any signs of response. She doesn't even flinch as she keeps staring up. Dang it, she can't hear. What is she even up to? Isn't that Karen-chan? Hey, you mean Nikaido? Karen Nikaido. My heart races as I recall that name. Ooh, a sweetheart, maybe. I squint to get a better look. It does sort of kind of look like her. That's dangerous! I showed her once more, and she finally looks here. She doesn't react much, however, and just looks at us disinterestedly. After some time, maybe she finally got bored, she opens up the fence's door and goes back inside. What a relief. I can't see her from outside anymore. What was Karen-chan up to? Who knows? After some time, Karen Nikaido comes out from the Tokyo building. A sharply ironed uniform, long flowing black hair, and pale, clear skin. Her dignified appearance makes her out to be a level above us mere mortals. I've always thought she was pretty. The red ribbon in her hair suits her otherwise monochromatic look. Take a look around, see if there's anything else interesting going on here. Alright. Karen, here, for you. For me? Thanks. She has the ribbon I gave her back in middle school. Seeing that ribbon always reminds me of that moment. Wait, now's not the time to be reminiscing. What the heck were you thinking doing on the roof? That was way too dangerous. Karen and I lock eyes, her eyes widen in surprise. What? Are you Sakura-kun? That I am. What about it? Ignored. Did I do something to her? She's definitely on the quiet side, but she'd normally reply if anyone talked to her. I whisper to you. Hey, why'd she snub me like that? Did you do something to her? You can be pretty thoughtless sometimes. Yay me. I didn't even have the leisure to do something in the first place. Karen stares me down from the top of my head down to the heels of my shoes. We used to talk all the time back in elementary. Our middle and high schools were the same, too, but since middle school, she barely talks to me anymore. Maybe I judged our distance wrong? Karen, can you come to Shibuya too, huh? You came to Shibuya too, huh? I didn't exactly come. Before I knew it, I was already here. What do you mean, before you knew it? What's the last thing you remember? I don't know. So she'll answer like normal, except with me? Seriously, did I do anything to her? My memory is hazy. Just that I was already on the rooftop amusement park when I came to. The amusement park? What a throwback! The one on the Tokyo building rooftop. We got together pretty often there as kids, right? When we were little kids, the eight of us often played together there. The park would always be empty, so that was where we often hung out. Karen-chan, did you see anyone from the top of the building? Not sure. I was just looking up at the sky the whole time. Why the sky? Because I like the sky. The sky. Now that I think about it, she did look up at the sky pretty often. She didn't as a little kid, but I think it was around middle school she would sometimes just randomly look up. In an art club, she would always use sky as a theme for all her work. Maybe she would have had some kind of strong attachment to it? There's, like, literally no one here at all. Do you have any clue? I don't. No. Even in a situation like this, Karen shows no sign of panic, clearly maintaining her composure. Even though you and I are worried to death from the isolation, she seems completely unaffected. I bet if she were the only person left in the world, she'd get along just fine. Nikaido, how... In an instant, my vision goes completely black. Well, that's downright unsettling. A softness envelops my entire face. It's kind of extra unsettling. It takes me by surprise. I shake my head left and right, trying to get rid of whatever it is, but my sight remains dark. What? What the hell? What's going on? My mind's a mess. I try to get you to help me, but I hear a familiar snicker from behind me. Guess who? Oh, Yuria-chan. You're not supposed to tell him that. The veil is finally lifted from my eyes. I turn around to see a girl grinning. She's got a lab coat on. In her left hand is a pretty freaky-looking stuffed toy. That's probably what she pressed against my face.
Hello, Sakura-kun. Momono-kun, Nikaido-kun, what a coincidence. So Yuria Togoku says...
So Yuria Togoku says as she gives this little peace sign. Togoku, you're here too?
Hello, Togoku-san. Well, well, ever the proper girl, even at a time like this, Nikaido-kun.
Togoku, my head already hurts from all this weird stuff going on. Don't scare me like that.
Oh, scary. Quit getting so mad at everything. When I woke up, I was in Shibuya all of a sudden. There wasn't anyone at all. I was so scared I could have just collapsed on the spot.
Doesn't look like that at all, though. She doesn't even have a shred of anxiety in her. Seeing both Karen and Yuria's totally abnormal reactions to showing up in this place is really messing with my sensibilities.
You need to be more delicate with girls, you know? So... What in heavens is going on here?
No idea. The three of us pretty much found ourselves here when we came to.
Well, now, that's the same with me then. I went to sleep at home, then woke up in front of a fancy shop and had no idea what was going on. No one was around, so I decided to just head to the station.
You don't know either?
Is there ever something you actually don't know? The great genius Yuria-chan doesn't know? If even Tagoku-san doesn't know, then of course none of us would. Wow, you're really piling it on here.
Boy, it's gonna be hard keeping any of the voices I do, bad as they are, straight. Whew, alright. I've been friends with Yuria Tagoku since grade school. She's what you call a prodigy. She won some kind of big physics prize back in middle school and even showed up on TV. Among all my childhood friends, Yuria is the one who I most trust when it comes to knowledge and critical thought. It feels like you could learn just about anything just by listening to her. Someone after my own heart. I know absolutely nothing of what's going on. Well, quite. And I totally gave the wrong voice to that. Suck it up. Alright. Hey, you know something about what's going on?
Slow down. Slow down. Don't get your hopes up. I don't have any proof yet, so I can't say for sure yet.
Come on, don't leave us all hanging here. Just tell us.
Now, it's only going to make everyone more worried.
Yuria has a side to her. Even if she has some info, useless, she's got hard evidence. She won't say anything. A real empiricist. Conversations are never black and white. Anyway, they just kind of happen. So I do want her to be a little more lax with these kinds of things.
I really want to know. Just tell us. I want to hear what you think. And besides, as you were talking about here, it's probably right on the mark. Alright then. I'll make an exception this time.
Whatever Yuria says is probably the right answer. She's never been wrong. She grins and mutters, like she's spilling the beans on something to us.
Humanity has gone extinct.
For a moment, we're all stunned into silence.
Apart from us, for humanity's perished. Well, we're all that's left.
We're not exactly sure what to make of what Yuria just said. It's like time is frozen and none of us knew what to say to that. Humanity has gone extinct? I just can't believe it. But with the deathly silence that surrounds us within the entire Shibuya, and the fact that it's Yuria positing this, I can't help but think that it is really the case.
You mean... Everyone is dead. Fathers, mothers, brothers, friends, all dead. No way!
Humanity is extinct? What does she mean? That we're the only ones left? There's no way that could be possible. Could it? The fact of the matter is, there's no one else here but us. It's midday, but the trains are all stopped, and normally bright screens and loudspeakers are silent. Humanity has gone extinct. Maybe it would make perfect sense for that to happen. Part of me accepted that possibility, but it just didn't feel real. How are we going to live the way things are?
Just kidding. It's a joke. A joke!
Anyway, it doesn't matter. Alright.
Huh? You should have seen the looks on your faces.
What? Wait, what?
Humanity can't have gone extinct. Even for Tagoku-san, that's too much of a stretch for her to say. Looks like you didn't fall for it, Nikito-kun. What a shame.
Wait, were you just tricking us?
I sure was. That's awful. It's your fault for getting tricked.
So it was all just a big lie? Please don't joke like that. My heart can't take it. She ought to try getting told that humanity just went extinct.
Sorry, but at least you understand why. I don't just say things without anything to prove it, right?
Yeah, sorry for forcing it out of you.
You're just making excuses now. I bet you just said that to mess with me. I mean, you kind of believed it, even without any proof. See, you're laughing just thinking about it.
Jeez, what are you two even... It's nice to see the banter between the two. Our fear and anxiety brought about by the state of events subsides, even just a little. Thanks to Goku. For better or for worse, she just isn't the type to read the mood. She just does whatever she wants and brings everyone else into it. Which was somewhat comforting in our situation. Nakaido is watching the other two a few steps back. She's the kind of type of frizzy but distance from the usual circle. That's kind of me, actually.
Hey, Kaido. What? Why are you keeping your distance? Did I do something? Not really. I'm just keeping enough space between us. Did she always avoid me like this? Since when, though? Since when did things get awkward between us? I think we got along just fine in elementary. Maybe it's because of the innocence that came with our youth. But now we're strangely conscious of each other. At some point, we simply stopped talking and lost contact. Did something happen? What created that divide between Nikaido and I? I can't remember. Are those people? Oh, hello, way over there. Huh? Where? We're building the crew. Ah, they're over in Central District. As I look toward that area, I can certainly see silhouettes of people. 1, 2, 3. Looks like they've noticed us and they're waving at us. Oh, they're there. There we go. When I squint, I realize it's familiar faces. Kamiya? Tetsu-kun and Tetsu-kun and Ai-chan too. Really good eyes there, you. I've been training them every day. What for? Because you're in the photography club? Something like that. Is eyesight really important for being in the photography club? I don't think it's an absolute must. She doesn't seem too surprised that the three of them are there. With all three of them, their commonalities come together naturally. Kamiya, Moritsumi, and Kageyama. Even in this bizarre state of affairs, it feels normal for them to be together. Ever since high school, the three of them have always been together for student council work. Hey! Wow. I'm never going to be able to get enough voices for all these characters. Forget it. I can't. Okay. Take a momentary break to grab a little bit of water. I'm hoping this game does have some choices to it, but even so, this visual novel style in VR in these three dimensions is actually kind of a compelling thing. I think I would need more interactivity in order to make it really compelling for me, but so far I do kind of want to see where this is going. Anyway, Kamiya, alright. Wow, this is a surprise. Everyone's here. I can say the same here. That's Kiyosuke Sakura-kun and Yu Momono-san, Karen Nikaido-san and Yuria Togoku-san. Kamiya-kun already said everyone. My bad. I thought there'd be someone else besides us here. It's sorry. I gravely apologize. I'm never going to be able to do this. You're so strict, Morizumi. You really don't need to be so particular with his word choice. That is true. Just as Kamiya-kun says, one choice of words is a trivial thing. Forgive me for that, Kageyama-kun. it's nothing. Same as always, huh, Morizumi? The usual 180 I've grown used to seeing. Morizumi always takes Kamiya's side on things like a loyal companion. Since first year middle school, Sai Kamiya has regularly been elected SC president. He's like the absolute ruler of the school. And Ai Murazumi stays by Kamiya's side as a secret aide, or rather as the SC secretary. With those two in the spotlight, Tetsu Kageyama supports them from the shadows as the SC treasurer. The three of them and I have known each other since elementary. So, what's going on here? That's what I want to know here. I woke up from a good night's sleep, and I'm in the middle of Shibuya without a single soul in sight. I just figured I could meet with people by the station. I see. We're pretty much the same then.
After waking up, I found myself in Shibuya. Morizumi and Kageyama and I met up along the way. You didn't see anyone else? Nope, nobody. I was pretty surprised. It looks like there really isn't anyone else. I'm completely lost as to what exactly is going on, as always. Still, for just us childhood friends to gather like this goes beyond a mere coincidence. Yes, the commonality between all of us here, that we're all friends since childhood. What the heck is going on here? Did you see the wall? Wall? You haven't, I take it. That mirror wall, it probably goes all the way around Shibuya. A circular wall, eh? Cylindrical, too, to be precise. It goes all the way up, too. I see. Well then, a mirror wall, eh? A giant mirror wall that goes all the way around Shibuya? Like, big enough to completely enclose the entire district? It's so out of the ordinary that I can't even imagine what it's like. I gaze up overhead to the sky and see there isn't even a cloud in sight. I guess that's kind of true. I don't see anything resembling a wall. A wall? The heck? Don't ask me. That's just that there's a monolithic, mirror-like wall all around. I doubt we can scale it. That's why I decided to head to the station instead. I thought maybe the trains would be running. Yeah, good thought. Just by the looks of it, though, they aren't. I figured as much. My head hurts. After being swept away in this turn of events, things are already far beyond my realm of understanding. I'll definitely need time to swallow this all. I glance at Kamiya, who's calmly discussing things with the Goku. I expected no less from him. No matter what the situation is, he never loses his composure. Though he said it would, he was surprised, it didn't look to be the case at all. Kamiya inherited his leadership skills from his dad, a big-time politician. He uses those skills to show us the right paths to take. I'm sure, like so many politicians. You know, it's been a while since we got everyone all together like this, huh? Now that you mention it. Back in elementary, we were always together, like we were family. Before we knew it, we fell out of touch with each other, and we all went our separate ways. Did everyone really get really busy? We don't get together as often now. Of course. We can't all just remain as grade schoolers. What else can we do? Wonder if I got her an okay voice? I'm not sure. Well, I mean, one I can live with, not one that everybody appreciates. So suck it up, viewers. Anyway, that's true. That's true and all, but it's still kind of sad. Don't be silly. Growth is good. Inconsistent voices at that. Now, it's nice to stop, take a breather, and look back on things once in a while. You're right, just like Kamiya-kun says, sometimes it's all right to reminisce and be pensive. What? Nope, nothing at all. Getting into an argument with Morizumi is nothing but trouble. Let's let it slide. All right, if we're gathering everyone from the old days, there's still one more guy left, the noisy one. Ah, now that you mention it. It was always eight of us together, and the idiot who always caused the commotion among us, and we'd love him for it anyway, isn't here. I bet he's here in Shibuya too. With the seven of us together, it definitely wouldn't feel right without him here, yeah. Everyone knows each other since we were kids, but still, to bring all eight of us together would be another unbelievable coincidence on top of all this. Hey, yo! From Central District, I look at him and see another familiar face. I hear a voice from the distance. It's one I've heard before. Speak of the devil, as they say. Machikoji by himself shows up. Great. Sorry, but I was just so glad. It's alright, just that kind of surprised me. You're here too, just like I thought. Yo, what the... Yo, what the hey is going on here? When I came to, I was already here in Shibuya. Hey, relax, we're all in the same boat here. It just happened to everyone here too. Like I said, what's going on? We haven't figured out that part yet. Like placing the final piece of the puzzle, Machikoji enters our circle. Now the group of childhood friends is complete. And at that moment, I breathe a sigh of relief. Everyone is here. For some reason, I find solace in that. Nikaido looks right at me, her expression blank. It startles me for a moment, and I feel a little embarrassed. Maybe I just wanted to explain myself as I start to do just that, even though she doesn't prompt me to. Say, Nikaido. Ignore it again. Well, all right, I'll just keep talking regardless. I'm about to say something that makes absolutely no sense, but, what? Contrary to expectations, Nikaido reacts. For some reason, seeing her nod makes me just a little happy. I don't really understand why I feel this way either, but... Yes? Just that this might be exactly what I wanted to see. Really now. Nikaido remarks, uninterested, and shifts her gaze towards everyone else. Looking off in some faraway scenery, into some faraway scenery, she stares at them intently. My chest tightens seeing all this. As for why, I don't know. Feels as if all of this is this moment is just ever so important. Like I'd always wanted this for the longest time, and now I finally have it in my grasp. Even though this really isn't anything, even though I'd seen this countless times already, how come? I'm here having an emotional moment, and in contrast, the Kaido is just there, poker-faced. If that's what you think, then maybe it is. Yeah, I'm sure. I get a pretty cold reply back, but after being able to put my thoughts into words, I manage to calm down some. This is definitely Shibuya, but something's clearly up here. Whoops. Alright. You know what? While I'm in here, I... I think I'm gonna go with that height. What does this do? Oh, that's for that panel. Any other config? Preferred hand, right hand is fine. Vertical follow is on, that's also fine. Okay, I'm good with all this. Ooh, we should probably save. Oh, there's an auto save, but let's save manually anyway. Oh, is there a log of, ooh, that's good. All right, in case I miss anything. All right, back to the story. This something is probably on the global scale. Well, maybe. And if my gut's right, not good at all. What's going to happen now? Despite these doubts, I have a feeling that us eight, we can manage somehow. We've got the Mystery Machine crew together, it looks like. As if she'd picked up on my gut feel, Togoku steps forth with an uneasy expression. She's always laughing her head off, so whenever she looks serious, we know that things are headed in a bad direction. Could I have a moment, everyone? What's up? What's up, Yuria? Everyone quiets down and waits for Togoku to continue. Her tone of voice doesn't have its usual playful cheer. Rather, it carried it with a grave seriousness. There's something I need to speak about with you all. Something you need to talk about. It's pretty important, you see. With the way you're building us up, I'm getting kind of scared. My intuition seems to be on the mark. The mood is pretty heavy. Humanity is extinct. Maybe that wasn't just a joke. She's about to tell us the gravity of our current situation. Here is my conjecture regarding this current world of ours. It's about time for us to face this inexplicable phenomenon head on. Fun times over. Are you familiar with the Balashika incident? Yeah, I do. Balashika, right? It's pretty well known. Balashika, what's that? It was a pretty big issue on the internet for a while. In 1988, Balashika City, Moscow, Russia, a 13-year-old boy and his mother went missing. Despite searches by the police, there were unnaturally absolutely no traces of their disappearance, and the case went cold. A year after the disappearance, they found the boy in a nearby forest. Or rather, he couldn't really be called a boy anymore. His hair had turned white and had a long beard like some kind of homeless old man. They had only found out that it was the missing boy, because he named himself as such, which was confirmed by a later DNA test. He no longer knew his own age, but he was deemed to be around 60 years of age based on tests. My mother and I lived in a balashika that had no one else inside. From his testimony, he and his mother had found themselves in a world where everyone else had suddenly disappeared. After traveling some distance, they found a sort of mirror wall that imprisoned them, and they couldn't find any way to break through it. Left without any other choice, he and his mother lived in that deserted balashika for about 50 years. That's what it was about. A mirror wall. Yes, indeed. This world we're in might be the same as in the balashika incident. That's what I'm thinking. No, wait a minute here. That's clearly some crazy supernatural occult stuff right there. It's gotta be something supernatural because that can't possibly be real. Sakura-kun, that's where you're wrong. Something isn't supernatural because it can't happen in real life. It's supernatural because it's beyond what science can explain. Same thing, right? Not at all. Not in the slightest. Science is merely what we can manage to record of our world. But it's not everything. Anything more is just outright scientific arrogance. Regardless, science can help show hints of what could be. The Bermuda Triangle, Agatha Christie's 11 Missing Days, Kinloss, the Mary Celeste, entire families in Japan disappearing. You could pin some sort of scientific explanation for all of them. So you're saying the Balashika incident could actually have happened? That I am. The fact of the matter is, we're all in that very same unthinkable situation, being in a closed-off world as we speak. Even someone who only believes what they see has no choice but to accept this. Though I was skeptical and voiced my doubts towards Tegoku, she shot back with cold hard facts. Well, relax. I know just a thing or two about the Balashika incident. My little sister looked into it too. Oh, that's great! I expect nothing less from the genius sisters. Everyone in Yuria-chan's family is pretty much a genius. Tegoku smiles at Yu's praise for her, then continues to explain. My sister refers to this closed-off space as the Chronos world. Chronos world. Chronos world. I hear that name a lot in games and stuff. The name of a god or something? Indeed, since you're trapped in a world where time seems to be frozen, she named it after the Greek god of time. Arguably the father of Zeus, if I recall. So, Tegoku, is it possible for us to get out of here safely? So, about the Balashika incident, how exactly did the guy manage to get back to the real world? He may have lived for 50 years in Chronos world, but he definitely did get back home. There's already a precedent, which means all hope isn't lost. Oh, right. He managed to get back, so that means we can get back too, right? Yes, it is possible. Then come on, let's go. How do you do it? In the Balashika incident, the boy was able to return to the real world thanks to his mother's death. Well, that just got a bit dark. That's another bad joke, right? According to my sister, Chronos world occurs because of a certain trigger. Once that certain objective is fulfilled, the world will close all on its own. In other words, we need to find what created this Chronos world and get rid of it. And what is that? And why am I hearing static?
Take a look there, everyone.
I am dead. Who killed me? Maybe the ghost of the mother who had to perish to get out of the previous incident, whose name is now filtered out of my brain because I have the memory of a thing that swims around as scales. Hello. All of that was just the intro. Figures. Well, we're treated to a cutscene. Now, from my perspective, I'm hoping you can hear this, because it's hard for me to... This is probably going to get me a copyright strike. So, let's see if I... I'm going to cut out the audio for this entirely. I apologize, but just in case it matters. And I will try to keep focused on the actual imagery. Now, this is playing for me on a flat panel. Oh, no, this isn't. Oh, okay. Okay, okay, I'm digging this. And I missed the transition from 2D to 3D. But going from a flat panel visual as sort of a classic anime intro on a television screen, we now have three-dimensional models floating in front of me. That's actually a really nice touch. Very classic sort of anime, you know, group of friends intro style. I want to know who that character is. All right. Well, dang. Let's see if I can... up the audio a little bit. Yes, we're gonna save progress. Sure. That was entirely just the intro, which makes sense. Now, I'm given to understand... I'm given to understand that this game is about 15 hours long. I read fairly quickly, but I'm also looking around a lot and taking pauses and commenting on things about the game. So I would guess this is going to take me a while to finish, even if it's just novel style and doesn't involve any choices. But I have no idea. They might, if there are choices in this game, they might have kept it out of the intro because they wanted the intro to just get us to here. So I don't know anything more about where this game is going. The question is, do I want to keep going into the next chapter or break this up into pieces? I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop it here and start it up again after I've gone and grabbed myself a snack, because it's getting into the afternoon and I haven't had anything since a very early breakfast. And yeah, maybe what I will do is I will actually set up to playing this every weekend will burn a lot of weekends. If I only do an hour at a time. Might have to do hours during the week. I might have to do more than a single hour. I'm going to have to play this one by ear. Let me see how I feel about doing more of this this afternoon. I'm invested enough that I at least want to see what the next non-intro chapter is to see how the game plays. So I'm going to call it here. I am never going to remember what voices I gave them, inconsistent as they were. So I apologize in advance, and I'll make this apology again next session. I don't know why I feel a need to do that. I guess I just like doing it, so suck it up. And I had seconds to come up with each one of them, so we're just going to have to run with it. I'm kind of digging the visual style, and I'm kind of digging the style of it being an interactive novel where I am in the space. That is actually really kind of cool. I'm hoping that eventually... they start doing it with full body avatars for me, because they could have done a body and I caved some elbows in here to give me more of a sense of presence. But this isn't bad. I kind of feel like I'm in the middle of an anime, if I'm being honest. And over time, as technology and art budgets allow, they'll probably increase the fidelity of the visuals. But the thing is, it not being photorealistic isn't the issue. Maybe slightly crisper sort of cartoon lines, as it were, animated lines, for like the boundaries of the trees and the boundaries of the buildings, a little crisper, eventually. And but you know what? It doesn't matter because I still feel like I'm in an anime space, and that's kind of the point. Doesn't have a lot of the choices that My Child Lebensborn has, but that had a much simpler animated style, and its focus was very, very different. And of course, it wasn't in VR. And I really want to know what's going on here. Whoops, what's going to happen to us now? I'm scared. That's going to be the next big mystery. All right. So, I think I will keep playing at least a few chapters of this to see if it grabs me. We'll have to see how that goes. I think I'm going to put this down, go find some food, and then figure out the rest of my day. In any case, thank you so much for joining me. This has been Code Weaver Plays Games, and I'll see you next stream.